6, 3, 4, 0, 2, 6, 5, 4, 8, 4, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, He church that God never said anything about. They're living in such a way that God never said to them. I want to serve God. But the minute you tell the truth, they start thinking, they start rebelling. I'm not going to do it. You know what, friend? That's rebellion. And all you do is hurt yourself. When you fight against God, when you rebel, you're fighting against God. That's all you're doing. You're fighting against God. You think that what you're doing is right, in reality, that you're fighting against God. Look at this. There's my name. He said to them, Lord, thou Lord, to the Lord said, have Jesus known thou persecutest? It is hard for thee to keep him as a priest. Now, what was Saul fighting against? What was it that was so difficult for Saul of Tarsus? You see, what he was doing, he was actually having trouble doing it. Because he was having some hurtful pain. It was bothering him because something, he knew something just had to be right, but yet he was still doing wrong. He was still killing these Christians, but something was getting very hard for him. He was kicking against the bricks that the ox go. He was kicking against the pointed stick that they used to pound the cattle. You see, something was bothering him. Back up in Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6, you read a man named Stephen. And Stephen was preaching the gospel. Look at this. Stephen full of faith and power is one of the favorite of the people. And they were the son of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines and the Cyrenians, and the Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia and of Asia, speaking with Stephen. Now, this is Saul of Tarsus right here. He was in Cilicia. And here he was listening to Stephen. I don't know if it's Stephen because later on they're going to lay their coats down at his feet when they get it. But look at the problem that Saul starts to have when he hears Stephen preach. They were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. See, Stephen was speaking by the Spirit, and his message was a divine message, and it was causing Saul of Tarsus some trouble. But yet, all this time, what he heard, he was trying to put it back. He was denying it. This can't be right. I can't answer what people say, but I know it's not right. See, he's fighting this. He rebelled. So what do they say? They bring false witnesses. They falsely accused Stephen. They wound up. They wound up killing him. Acts chapter 7 verse 58. The guy about the city laid down their clothes at a young man's feet with the name of Saul. But Saul was struggling. He was begging his God. And that's why when he meets Jesus on the road to Damascus, in Acts chapter 9, that's what he said. Is it hard for you to kick against the bricks? Is it hard for you to fight against the things that you know? Where are you when you have a job? consider this. Now, some of the other system, instrumental music, instrumental mechanical instrument music are accepted to God. He actually commanded them. But notice this. He says, I despise the feast days. I will not smell your salt offerings. Don't eat offered you by offerings to your meat offerings. I will not accept them. Neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat beasts. Take thou away from me the noise of thy songs, for I will not hear the melody of thy vials. And that judgment went down into the earth, and righteousness and mastery. He will offer me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years for our battle. For ye have borne the tabernacle of Moloch, and chided in your images the star of God, which ye made to yourself. Look, which you made yourself. Therefore, I will cause you to go into captivity beyond Damascus, said the Lord, whose name is the God of hosts. You come to worship me, and yet all you're doing is you're also including all of these things that you made to yourself. The things you want. Now, friend, let's be honest with ourselves. Let's be honest with ourselves. Do you really think that you're seeking the Lord with a pure heart and you're giving God the things that He wants? When you turn around and give Him what you want Him to have, do you really think that? Listen to what this lady says. This is what this lady says.
Thank you.
hilltop home. Don't be surprised if you don't get found up. I know she asked this question, could it be that God has withdrawn from some people's liberties and time? Could it be that there you are in all your difficulties in your plights, all the struggles in your life, there you are, that you can't find God? You can't find the peace of God you're understanding because you're looking for God with an insincere heart. You're trying to find Him in your own way, to your own pain, instead of seeing Him the way He wants to be found. Look, God doesn't see it. These people who seek me in sincerity, they will find me. They will find me because they are rebelling against the rules. They're rebelling against the rules. So they're not going to find me. And also, it's because they're indifferent to the rules. You see, at some point, people realize, you know what, I got right. I'm going to ride with the Lord. Look what Hosea says. When Ephraim's eyes sink as a Judas on his womb, then went Ephraim to the Assyrian and said to King Jacob, yet could he not heal you, nor cure you of your wound? He couldn't do it. You know what? These are things that realize I can't do it on my own. And then you start going to the Lord. But you go to the Lord after your own ways, doing what you want to do, because that's what pleases you, with no regard to what God says do. And God looks at it now. You don't really care about true healing. You don't really care about true righteousness. You're not Ephraim and Judah. They know that they're saved, but they won't. They know there's remedy, and they know there's a doctor, and they kill them, and they turn around and go over to the quack. They know there's a remedy, they know there's a doctor who can cure them, but instead of going to that doctor, they turn around and they go to someone who can't cure them. And what is that? Friend, let me tell you, if you don't want to be healed, and if you don't want to be blessings that God gives you, well, don't think God's going to give them to you. I think there's a lot of people who are like these folks in Revelation 3, the way I was saying this. Jesus said, you never ever told them. He said, but you think you're rich, but in reality, you're poor, naked, blind, and miserable. You think everything is going well with you, but in reality, you're in bad shape. You think everybody's fine, but in reality, you're in a bad way. You know why? I said, because sin makes people see their sickness. deal. Syria came against the land and Menahem had pulled a thousand tiles of silver, that his hand might be with him to confirm the kingdom's hand. And Menahem exacted the money of Israel, even of all the mighty men of wealth, of each man 50 shekels of silver to give to the king of Syria. So the king of Syria turned back and stayed by the bare land. So he did. Menahem said, if you can protect me and protect the country, I will take up this tax of all the mighty men of Israel. And I will be there with this foreign king, and he will attack me. But you know who I'm coming and destroying Israel? It's Assyria. The very people that Israel come from here, the very people that they thought would save them, when they planned on saving them, didn't save them. And people in life today, they think that anybody who professes to believe in God. So they don't care about the religion. They don't really care about what the Bible says. They don't really care about the word of the Lord. They just care if someone tells them it's saved them. My faith never said anything about it.
But I wonder if I'm going to ask him.
I don't know that. But she does know this. You know, she knows that when we say there's one church in the Bible as a church of Christ, that you have to be in that kind to be saved. You don't have trouble being saved. She knows that. That's scary. Because you won't see God. You won't find God until you repent. Until you acknowledge His way around. You're one of the Lord's people of prayer. Hey.
I'm doing
well.
I'm
doing
well.
All right. Be too later on. That cries never. access of the Father that gives them their good evil. Right. You're on a purple line.
I'm
Yeah.